when you talk about environmental concerns, that is one area where it seems we could say science and spirituality, or we could statistics and religion, they have come together. So can you elaborate that a little bit more?
Right. So actually, environmental concerns have prompted various leaders and thinkers, including the United Nations, to understand the power of faith. And then there is an entire stream which is very, very popular, substantial, and influential called eco-theology. And as the climate crisis continues to grow, and the deadline for the attainment of the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, by 2030 draws closer, so we have to recognize that more and more actors are rallied into climate action. Because if you have to transition into a sustainable future, it must be a global effort. It can't be just a few activists here and there shouting slogans. So therefore, the holistic vision of sustainable development, which is embedded within the Sustainable Development Goals, it implores that all stakeholders, from individuals to nations, and from grassroots NGOs to multinational corporations, everybody contributes to their achievement. Just imagine if the house is on fire, then every member of the house, whether they get a glass of water or a bucket of water or a hose pipe, everyone has to be engaged, and there's no time for someone to just sit and, see. So therefore, there were many untapped, undervalued contributors to these processes, and one of them are the faith-based organizations. They have long existed on the periphery of large, secular, multilateral organizations and their strategic plans. Faith-based organizations have always shared intrinsic notions that we have a moral responsibility and we do valuable work in the field of development, but they would never get a stage in these kind of climate conferences and things like that. So now they are becoming increasingly active on environmental issues, as all religions without fail contain messages on environmental care, on stewardship of the planet, that can provide for human flourishing, and with the notions that sustainability is embedded in their religious texts. So therefore, faith-based organizations are especially very valuable contributors to the SDGs, given this tremendous influence which they have. So over 80%, as I said, of the global population is affiliated to various communities, as I mentioned. For many, faith is the analytical lens which shapes their worldviews. And therefore, faith-based organizations, are sustainable institutions in themselves. They have frequently existed for centuries, and they have deeply connected networks. If you see, Udupi Math is around 800 to 1,000 years old. Ramanujacharya's is like that also. These are institutions which have been existing for a long time. If you see the church, it has been existing for thousands of years. So therefore, they have a method of having an organizational resilience which beats the ups and downs of all kinds of changes. So therefore, they're situated across the world, and many times faith-based organizations branch out in smaller centers and go to communities which are highly marginalized. So their reach is such that which corporates even many times cannot match. And therefore, to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals, what the UN is looking at is change in mindset, change in behavior, and change in the consumption patterns. And faith leaders are well positioned to relay such messages in a more relatable manner. And that is more easy for people to connect and absorb than abstract data through various kinds of graphics and presentations. Therefore, The United Nations Environment Program, Faith for Earth Initiative, was launched in 2017. And so Faith for Earth, it foremost aims to strategically engage with faith-based organizations to collectively contribute towards the sustainable development goals and fulfill the agenda of the 2030, you know, SDG agenda. So the initiatives mobilize new interfaith partnerships, utilize innovative approaches to unite around the common goal of sustainable development. So, you know, as you rightly said, and as you are such a powerful author on science and spirituality, the fact is that many people in spiritual circles are not aware of some of the extent to which we are faced with the problem of environmental pollution, because ultimately, whatever faith you may be from, but you have to live in your house. If you consider the earth to be a house, we have a common house with many rooms, and any damage which is happening to our house has to be dealt with from the perspective of the Vedic literatures. You know, Bhumi was considered to be Bhumi Devi in the fourth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Prithu Maharaj, you know, he rallied forward and very much intervened to make sure that Bhumi Devi responds appropriately. When Bhumi Devi is in distress in the 10th canto, the demigods approach Krishna to have Krishna appear. So therefore, if when you go for worship and darshan of Tirupati Balaji, you first take darshan of Bhudevi and then you go and take darshan of Balaji. So it's there in our tradition a lot, but the fact is that global fossil carbon dioxide emissions have risen, you know, almost 62% from 1990 to 2019. And today they are pegged at almost 36.5 million billion metric tons per annum, which is humongous. And the average global temperature in the 2016 to 2020 period is warmest on record, almost 1.1 degree higher than 1850 to 1990 period. So 2015 to 19, if you recollect, they were some of the five warmest years on record. And 2010 to 2020 has been the warmest decade on record. Yeah, so if you're sitting in an AC, you don't sometimes realize it. But, you know, air pollution, almost 7 million deaths worldwide are caused every year and costs almost US $5.1 billion, trillion dollars in...
Trillion? Okay.
$5.1 trillion in welfare losses globally. So, you know, if every year so many people are losing lives and so much of money is being spent, it means that we have to do something about there. And what to speak of water pollution, water, as they say, is life. And in future, they expect wars surrounding water. But, you know, at least, you know, we find that even after all the increase and enhancement in organizing water facilities for a majority of the people, still around 800 million people across the world lack the proper facilities for basic drinking water. And at least 2 billion people across the world still have no choice but to drink contaminated water, which is mixed with some degree of feces and bacteria. And, you know, the whole idea is that we think that if we bring about technology and have bottled water, then you bring in the plastic menace. Every single day, 8 million pieces of plastic pollution find its way into the ocean. And almost 12 million tons of plastic are poured into the ocean every year. And it's going to be a very, you know, not a long time from now, where there will be like a huge island of just plastic collected in some of these oceans. So, I mean, we have to take these things very seriously, because ultimately it is having impact on people's lives, on people's consciousness, on the anxiety levels. So you have to have a systems thinking approach towards this thing. And therefore, all the faith-based organizations with multifarious diversities and differences of opinion, which they may have, they may not be able to see eye to eye, you know, within the house. But when the house is on fire, you know, at least everybody at that time will not pick up a religious book and start fighting. But when the house is on fire, you take water and try to put out the fire in the best possible manner. So in that spirit, the faith-based organizations have been rallied by the United Nations and engaged in this particular agenda.